Then third element I'd like to touch on, structural policy analysis, very briefly. So here is the medium-term perspective of the region. Actually, the cutoff date of this data is last October, so maybe I think for some countries, maybe we need to revise the numbers, but I think you can get the rough idea of the growth momentum of the region. So if you look at the last line, as you can see, we expect that the average of ASEAN 10 countries growth rate this last 2015 will be around 4.6%. Next year will be 4.9%, and then for the next 5 years we expect around 5.2%. This growth rate actually quite exceptionally high compared with the current global trend. As you can see, OECD growth average will be around 1% and so on. So I'd say Southeast Asia is still a sort of growth engine in the world. If you look at the emerging Asian average, which includes China and India, growth rate is slightly higher, 6.5%, and then the next 5 years we expect around 6.2%. So I'd say, still, I think emerging Asia as a whole, still the region, medium-term prospect of the region is quite favorable. And when it comes to the ASEAN 5 economies, and I would say that the Philippines and Vietnam probably lead the growth of the region, which will be around 6% for the growth rate for the next 5 years. As for the Philippines, actually strong domestic demand, still I think robust for the next 5 years. In the case of Vietnam, actually recently, partly due to the macroeconomic management and also the private sector development, I think the growth momentum is becoming stronger and stronger. But when it comes to CLM country, less developed country, actually growth momentum is much higher than other Southeast Asian countries. For instance, we expect most of the all CLM country growth rate will be above 7%. In the case of Myanmar, it will be 8%. So I would say, and then when it comes to two large economies, China and India, actually growth momentum is changing. In the past, actually China achieved more than a double digit growth rate, but now it's close to 6.0%, probably a bit lower than we expect for the next 5 years. On the other hand, India growth rate will be relatively robust for the next 5 years. So I would say, among the ASEAN 5, Philippines and Vietnam will lead the growth in the region. CLM countries still strong growth momentum. China and India growth momentum is changing. So I would say this is a big picture of the medium term of the growth. So let me slightly touch on the macro issues. Probably one of the reasons some of the Southeast Asia countries showed a slight moderation from the last year, maybe I would say export. Other than Vietnam, most of the Southeast Asia countries suffer from the weak export trend actually beginning of last year, and this trend still continued. This is partly related to the China growth slowdown and also US global economy slowdown and so on. But I will touch on this issue a bit later. In addition to the export, actually, if you look at the investment trend varies between country by country. But some countries like Singapore and also Thailand actually show still weak investment momentum, but for instance, other countries are relatively stable. Consumption prospect is also similar. I would say in general, probably the latest data showed slight increase for the most of the Southeast Asia countries, but overall, I think the consumption prospect is still weak in the most of the Southeast Asia countries compared with the last 5 years average. This is notable, for instance, Thailand and also the Indonesia as well, and also the Malaysia. So in general, we think that growth prospect for the medium term will be favorable, but however, we identify few downside risks. First risk is the issue of China. But of course, the effect of the China growth slowdown will be observed through various channels, like export, FDI, finance, and so on. Maybe I think some of them already know that here, that actually the China's exchange rate is recently quite volatile, especially at last August. Actually, the China renminbi actually depreciated. And then after that, actually, most of the Southeast Asian currency actually affected very negatively. And then The last year, actually, three times China stock market actually crashed. But actually, I think from this, in this report, we think that actually the impact of the China growth slowdown, especially the financial market, will be limited. I think the impact of the stock market volatility will be probably even the impact within China, and it probably didn't go to the real sector even within China. Probably we think that the most strong channel will be export and FDI. Most of the Southeast countries will suffer from China growth slowdown from these two channels. But of course, the country will be, the country who might suffer from this impact will be different by FDI and also trade. In the case of trade, we think that Thailand probably will be most affected. In the case of FDI, Malaysia, Singapore probably will be most affected. And the next risk we think is actually the impact of the US monetary normalization. And here we did two scenarios, sort of a quick US monetary normalization and also slow monetary normalization. A quick monetary normalization is a scenario two, at which we think that the US monetary normalization will finalize Q3 2017. And a slow monetary normalization, we assume that the US monetary normalization process will be finalized by the end of 2018. So both cases, we use a DSGE model. So basically, this impact will be observed of the interest rate hike of the US, which affect the interest rate of the Southeast Asia country. And this is basically the negative impact of the real economy. So as you can see, as the ASEAN 5, roughly speaking, we expect around 0.56% over 0.56% to 0.68% of GDP. I would say this is relatively, the large size of the impact. But however, this model couldn't include, for instance, the capital inflow and outflow impact and the exchange rate impact. So I think this is a rough idea about the magnitude of the impact of US monetary normalization. But actually, we also conducted a similar type of simulation for the impact of the China growth slowdown on the region. Overall, we think that the impact of the China slowdown on the region will be probably more higher than the US monetary normalization in terms of GDP impact. And the third risk is actually the productivity. And if you look at the figure A, this is a potential GDP. And we have two lines. One line is actually the blue line, and another line, the red line. Red line is actually the sample of the productivity. Use a sample basically, including after the global financial crisis. And then this blue line is actually the productivity sample using before the crisis. As you can see, after the global financial crisis, actually, productivity of the emerging Asia decreased a lot. And so this is actually another important challenge country need to cope with to keep the growth rate relatively stable. And if you look at the structure, sectoral perspective, actually, you can also see the different angle. For instance, like a financial sector, actually the Indonesia, probably the productivity slowdown is much highest among the Southeast Asian country. And then construction area also, we can observe a relatively large number of the productivity slowdown after global financial crisis. We also conduct a similar type of analysis for the another sector, for instance, manufacturing and others. I think the impact is relatively small, but I think the impact of the financial sector is highest in terms of the productivity slowdown based after the global financial crisis. But I think considering the nature of the financial crisis, probably this is easy to understand. So another challenge, risk four, we think, especially this is focused on a CLM country, is a high level of the dollarization. And of course, we expect that growth rate of the CLM country will be quite high. And we think that for the next 5 years, 7-8% we expect. But however, a high level of the credit growth and also the high level of dollarization. At the moment, the inflation pressure is relatively subdued, so therefore I think this problem, this issue is not so visible, but I think that these countries still face a certain uncertainty in terms of the monetary policy management if the the country need to, if, as long as country has such high level of dollarization. So here is a big macro pictures. We identified the growth trend and also the four downside risks. And then let me touch on the regional integration challenges. This is a thematic chapter of the focus of this year. And overall, we think that the growth, the regional integration progress is relatively slow, even within the ASEAN or ASEAN plus 3 or ASEAN plus 6. In this report, we highlighted actually three recommendations. The first one is a better harmonization of the regional, sub-regional, or national planning. And the second issue is improving the monitoring scheme. And sadly, this report highlighted, actually the regional integration process of ASEAN so far has so much focus on the trade and investment. But however, this report highlighted maybe it's better to broaden the scope a bit more. That might, I think, be, make the regional integration process more effective. So let me elaborate a bit more on each point. So here actually is a sort of our assessment of the each policy areas, trading goods and trading services and tourism and so on, of the regional integration process. I will not touch on this slide in detail, but if you are interested in, I just give the organizer this USB key, because actually the full publication itself is 400 pages. Actually, it's not a dictionary, so but it's a comprehensive. So therefore, I think if you're interested, please ask the organizer to give the full report. But overall, we think that the progress is relatively gradual. The first point is we actually checked the alliance of the national plan and also the regional target, because each country has, as you know, the national plan. ASEAN regional integration plan has also the several policy areas which they like to strengthen the cooperation and integration as well. And then we checked more than 200 elements, and we actually, this is the result. Surprisingly, actually, the alliance of the national and the regional targets are quite limited. I think probably this is to some extent reasonable, because national plan usually created by the national planning agency. For instance, here in Indonesia it's BAPENAS, Thailand NSDB, and Philippines NEDA. And they created the target by sort of empirical analysis and so on. Their target numbers are quite strict in terms of the achievability and so on. But in the case of, for instance, ASEAN regional target, this was created by a bit more political I would say the size. For instance, the year 2015, this is a milestone important year, last year was not identified by some result of the simulation. It's more or less a political wing. Okay, 2015 is a milestone year. So I think this might be to some extent affect this result, but I think strongly, the number of percentage of strongly aligned is quite small. I think if the regional integration process would like to accelerate more, I think the strong alliance with the national plan is very important, especially in terms of the implementation aspect. Second message is actually the monitoring indicators. I just picked up the two typical indicators. One is the ASEAN Economic Scorecard, another is ASEAN Community Progress Monitoring System, but this one is prepared a long time ago, and it's more or less one shot. And not much updated. But the ASEAN scorecard, is, I think, is quite famous. But the problem is that it's a bit self-reported result. And also, we can't get it, especially for the public use, we can't use it. So this is probably it's a challenge. For instance, in the case of Europe, actually the European Union created the more detailed indicators in terms of the regional integration, and also actually sector level and all the frequently updated, and results are quite transparent. So I think the together with a good regional integration plan, good monitoring scheme is necessary. At the moment, I think the ASEAN doesn't have really comprehensive, I think the clear transparent indicators. I think this will be a challenge in the future. Another challenge I wanted to highlight is actually tackling the regional disparity plus global ASEAN. These two are actually, both are very important. One is actually issue within ASEAN. For instance, many of them already know that ASEAN started so-called IAI initiative. This is the intention is to narrow development gap. But actually the progress is very slow. And for instance, here we created so-called narrowing development gap indicators. And if the number is higher, the gap is higher. And then the number is small, the gap is small. As you can see, for instance, tourism area, the gap is quite small. So this means that actually the ASEAN countries conducted the sort of regional, narrow development gap effort well in this area. But however, the poverty and human capital development gap is still wide. So this means that the regions still need to cope with or still need more focus on these policy areas in terms of narrowing development gap. And another issue is global ASEAN. In addition to ASEAN, of course, there are several frameworks, some of them like ASEAN plus 3 and ASEAN plus 6. This report doesn't mention that which framework is better or not, but simply each framework has their comparative advantage. For instance, ASEAN plus 3 framework is quite advanced in the area of finance, like a CHEMMA initiative, follow-up, or liquidity support issues. And ASEAN plus 3, ASEAN plus 6 is, for instance, RCEP is progress in this framework. So I would say ASEAN or regional integration process could actually make effective use of the different existing framework. That's also another message of this report. Fourth and fifth message is the intention is similar. The intention is that we think that, of course, the regional integration process so far attained a lot of notable achievement. For instance, one of the big achievement is the inter-regional tariff. It's now slowing and it's close to zero. This is a big achievement. But when it comes to the other policy areas, still we think that the region could explore or expand the possibility of the integration. For instance, one area is the green growth and energy issues. Hydropower is a bit exceptional. This is because of the presence of Laos. But the most of the, I think, the renewable energy are still untouched. But we did some simple calculation that the impacts of the regional integration cooperation on export, especially of the regional renewable energy products. If they say the region reduce the tariff, actually export impacts will be, in most cases, like 3% and 5%. So I think still there are a lot of room to improve, especially the cooperation and regional integration in this area. Another issue is the private sector development. And here actually we, based on the Thomson data, we pick up our micro level data, and we actually listed the top 10 of the intra-ASEAN M&A. And for instance, in Europe, there are so many M&As between France and Germany and so other countries. But when it comes to ASEAN, actually the M&A prospects are slightly different. As you can see, the coverage of the country appeared in the list are limited, basically Thailand, Singapore, Malaysia. And then when it comes to the sectors, also it's limited, basically food and beverage, or basically low value added sector. So which means that still I think the most of the SME in the region and the private sector couldn't enjoy the cross-border activities, especially given the ASEAN is becoming a single economic market. I think at the moment this also related to productivity issues. Most of the SMEs focus on their relatively limited domestic market, and so therefore actually the productivity also limit based on that. But if the SME in the region can expand the scope of the activity toward the other countries, and then I think this could enhance the productivity and also strengthen. So I would say in this report we use the term ASEAN enterprises. That's also another important element. So finally, let me touch on the structure policy issues. This is an update. Actually, we did this first simulation 2 years ago, and we updated. This is a so-called best scenario simulation of estimated time required to become high-income countries for selected ASEAN Asian countries. And we use the definition following the World Bank. of the high income country based on the GNI per capita as of USD to 12,800 at the point of 2014. Growth projection is more or less following our projection model. And the population projection, we basically use a UN projection. So based on that, we think that Malaysia will join the high-income economies quite shortly, within 10 years. But China will be the next. And then Thailand and Indonesia and the Philippines require another 20 years. In the case of Vietnam, who recently joined the middle-income country, require another 40 years, and India as well. So I would say, so-called middle-income trap is not a near-term issue. It requires another 20 and 40 years to overcome. And I would say in this report, actually we touched on the middle-income trap more in detail in the previous edition of Outlook, but the middle-income trap is not the growth slowdown. It's basically the sort of a structural transformation from the factor accumulation traditional model, like including K and L, or to the more productivity-led growth. But the country in the region has more time, and anyway, the structural reform will take time. This is just an example. The structure of economy by industry from 2019 and 2012, we just categorize service industry and agriculture. Roughly speaking, I think some country like China is moving and shifting the economy toward more service-oriented growth. But some countries like Thailand and Indonesia, the structure of economy are more or less the same for the last 20 and 30 years. So finally, in this report, different from actually the ADB and others, we have a country note focus on structural policies. And then the topic of the structural policy will be different by country by country. In the case of I don't probably go through all these points, but I would say in the case of Indonesia, infrastructure, social security, food security, these are important. And Malaysia, SME, education, and green growth, and the Philippines, job creation, and so on. So I think if you are interested, please also have a report. So, okay, that's a rough. I think the report itself is, 400 pages, so then during the 30-minute presentation, maybe I can't convey all the messages, but roughly speaking, I think that's sort of a nutshell we like to convey. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Dr. Karakter. Now, can I invite comment questions? Yes, Professor Nishimura. Okay, please.
Thank you very much. Excellent presentation. But I have the